Welcome back to the eShikshana program. We will continue with our lecture sessions on electrical power quality. This is Professor Uma Rao from RV College of Engineering bringing you the lectures. So in today's class, we will see about interfacing the distributed generation to the utility. Now, the power quality at the point of interconnection of DG to the utility depends mainly on what is the energy conversion technology. Like how are we converting the energy, any form of energy to electrical energy. So we have seen that there are different DG technologies, starting from solar, wind, using engines, fuel cells, all of them. So what is the technology we use? And the second is, how do we interface the output of the DG to the grid? So these are the two parameters which affect the power quality at the point of interconnection. There are also other causes of concern for power quality. One is, if we use wind and solar technology, which is dependent on the weather, then we can have dynamically changing voltages based on the wind speed, which varies, or the solar irradiation, which varies. And this can cause voltage fluctuations. Clear? So this is one problem. Now, we saw micro turbines in the previous session and fuel cells. So these do not follow a step change in load quickly, okay? So the transient period is large and they'll take some time to reach steady state and meet the load change. And therefore such technologies may have to be supplemented with a battery or fuel wheel storage. So to achieve improved reliability. So after all, the concept, one of the main concepts of distributed generation is that whenever the utility cannot meet the load, right? So we call it as the unmet load, then the DG should take over. That is, so they're expected to improve the reliability. Apart from standalone systems, which act as the only source of electrical supply. So to improve reliability, we may have to add on some energy storage device along with the micro turbines and fuel cells when we use the DG as a standby power. The third problem which can arise is misfiring of reciprocating engines. So we saw that engines coupled to a generator, these are also used as distributed generations. And what is the problem with this? So with this, you can have, it doesn't fire properly. And because of this, you can have a very irritating flicker. And this can be even magnified depending on the configuration of the power system at the point of interconnection. So these are some of the other issues we are likely to have with distributed generation. So now in this session, we will primarily take up the different kinds of interfaces we have. Interface means what is the kind of equipment I have, which will act as an interface between my DG and my grid or the utility. So we will take three of the most popular ones. First is the synchronous machines. Okay, so I might have an engine with a synchronous machine, a diesel generator. So the prime mover is connected to an alternator, that is a synchronous machine. So this forms a very popular interface for DGs. The second type of interface is asynchronous machines. These are induction machines, induction generators. So induction generators are very commonly used with wind turbines, because with varying wind speed, it is very difficult you know, to get a constant voltage, and therefore induction generators are very popularly used with wind turbines. And the third is electronic power inverters. So these inverters, wherever my source is DC, like for example a battery or a fuel cell, I have to convert or take a solar, where the output of the source is DC, I have to convert it into AC if I want to interconnect it to the grid. So I need an inverter in between. So these are the three popular interfaces between the DG and the utility: synchronous machines, asynchronous machines, and power inverters. So we will see each one of them and see what is the power quality problem they may give rise to, and if there is any other issue with this interfacing. So first, synchronous machines. So they are alternators. So now you know that all the alternators, they have to be synchronized. They have to be synchronized. So alternators are excited by DC. So you have a DC excitation for the field, and the alternator voltage is brought up to the grid voltage and synchronized at the point of interface. So what you should understand here is that in a synchronous machine, it's a constant speed machine. It's a constant speed machine. So the field will control the voltage level, and the governor of the prime mover, whether it's an engine or a turbine, whatever it is, that will control the speed and vis-a-vis the frequency. So by controlling properly the field and the governor, we can make the machine to follow any load change that might occur, as long as it's within the design capability. That means I design the machine for a particular range of loads. So as long as the load is within that, we can make the machine to follow the load. Now, alternator is a rotating machine. So it has some inertia in it. So there is some energy stored in the kinetic energy of the machine. So this will make it tolerant to step changes in load, because the kinetic energy can be released and converted into electrical energy. Now, it can sustain inadvertent islanding. We will just see in the next slide what is this islanding, which can occur when the utility feeder breaks open. See, at the point of interface, what do I have? I have the DG synchronized with the grid, right? So there are faults possible on the grid side, and there are faults possible on the DG side. So these two are actually parallel. These two, when you synchronize, we are paralleling these two sources. That means you are paralleling the DG source with the utility, right? So if the utility breaker opens, then we should see how the interface of the DG can affect the operation, right? So we will just see it subsequently. And now, since this is a source, it is an active source, the alternator. So if there is a fault at the terminals, it can feed the fault. Okay. So even the voltage becomes zero, even though the voltage becomes at the terminal becomes zero, you have an induced EMF. You have an induced EMF. So just think, you have an alternator running and there's a sudden short circuit at the terminals. There's a fault at the terminals. What will happen? The terminal voltage becomes zero, but the internal EMF is still there because it is still excited, and therefore it will pump in a huge amount of fault current into the fault. Clear? So this will affect, and it will interfere with the protection scheme on the utility side, because this fault current may not have been accounted for when the protection is designed for the utility. Clear? So these are some of the issues when you use synchronous generators. Now you can operate a synchronous generator. I'm sure you would have studied in machines in three modes. One is I use it to supply a constant power factor. Clear? That means I try to modulate the excitation. I try to control the excitation so that my power factor is at some specified value. That is called as the constant power factor control. Okay. The second control is the constant var exciter control. That means I supply or absorb a constant reactive power, that is var. That is another possibility. The third one is what is called as the voltage regulation mode. That means I keep adjusting the reactive power to maintain the terminal voltage a constant. That means I use it for voltage regulation. Okay, so what are the three modes? Constant power factor, constant var, or constant voltage, voltage regulation. Normally, whenever we interconnect, we operate it in constant power factor or constant exciter mode. The reason for this is, if I want to regulate the voltage, right, the terminal voltage, how do I regulate the terminal voltage? By controlling the internal voltage. How do I control the internal voltage? Through the DC excitation. So as my terminal voltage fluctuates, remember at the terminals, it is interfaced with the utility. At the terminals, it is interfaced with the utility. So if there is a fault on the utility side, this voltage may vary vastly. And if the synchronous machine is trying to keep the voltage, regulate the voltage, then the excitation may have to vary by a wide amount. Let us say there's a deep sag, there's a deep voltage sag because of a fault. Then if the excitation tries to see that the terminal voltage goes to the pre-fault value, then the excitation has to increase highly. Okay. Similarly, the reverse, the voltage may go up and then the excitation has to reduce. So this value of excitation required may not be within the capacity of the exciter, may not be within the capacity of the exciter. Clear? So this is one problem when we use synchronous machines for constant voltage regulation. We don't do it. That's why we use it either in constant power factor or constant VAR, right? Because they may not have enough capacity to regulate the voltage when they are interconnected. And apart from this, see, I have a voltage regulation plan on the utility side. I have tap changing transformers, right? And I have other maybe conventional generators in the utility, which all have automatic voltage regulators. So if I try to, you know, wherever the DG is interfaced, if I try to use the DG also for voltage regulation at that point, it may interfere with my plan for the utility voltage regulation, whatever I've already designed the utility for. Please remember, these DGs nowadays, especially on the distributed side, are like add-ons. We are adding them onto a system for which we had not planned. We had not planned the DGs in the original system. This is another reason why we don't operate in the voltage regulation mode. And the third is, same thing, it will prevent the exciter from hitting the limits. The exciter may have to go to the maximum limit during voltage sags, and minimum limit during voltage swells. And this frequent hitting of the limit is not good for the life of the exciter. And so this will prevent that. And it will reduce the chance of sustained islanding. What is islanding? We will see, and then we'll come back to this. What is islanding? See what happens. Let us say I have interfaced the distribution generation and the utility. So they're actually in parallel. You can visualize it like this. They are in parallel. Okay. Now for some, so, and the load is also connected in parallel. The load is also in parallel. For some reason, the utility, is removed because there is a fault on the utility side. It is removed. Now what is happening? The DG, it may be small, compared to the utility. The amount of power supplied by the DG may be small compared to the utility, but the DG is still connected to the load. The DG is still connected to the load. So what will happen is, this is called as islanding. When the DG feeds the load, even after the utility is cut off, when the electrical utility is cut off or the grid is removed. So one of the major problems with this is that the operators, they will see that the utility circuit breaker is open, etc. Right? They may try to do something, but the connection is live because there is a parallel power feed from the DG. The operator may not be aware of it. Right? See, just see in the lab, in the lab, supposing you synchronize exactly the same position, what I'm telling now. Let us say you synchronize an alternator in your machine's lab to the grid. Right? So I'm sure even if you have not done it practically, at least you would have studied the lamp dark method and so on. So I use a switch and I close. Okay, in parallel. I parallel the utility and the alternator, the grid and the alternator. Now let us say I remove the grid. Not because of any fault, I simply remove it. What is happening to the alternator? Alternator is still connected. So those terminals are live. There is a supply. And if there is any load connected, the load will be fed from the alternator. The load will be fed from the alternator, right? And so supposing now I see that the utility is open and I try to remove the load, I'll get a shock. In fact, it has happened in labs. In my 34 years of experience, students who are careless or who do not pay attention when we do, they have got massive shocks because of this, right? So this is islanding. So what is islanding? It is a condition in which a distributed generator like solar panel or wind turbine continues to generate power and feed the grid, even though the electricity power from the electrical utility is no longer present. And it exposes the utility workers to life critical dangers of shocks and burns, who may think that there is no power once the utility power is shut down, but the grid is still powered due to the distributed generators. Here, this is islanding. Now, the process or the act of preventing islanding is called as anti-islanding. So we must have anti-islanding strategies in place whenever we connect DG to the utility. So what is this anti-islanding strategy? As soon as the utility is cut off, immediately the DG also must be removed. The DG also must be removed, right? So if I use in constant power factor or constant var exciter mode, then this will reduce the chance of sustained islanding, because the voltage will quickly, if I try to maintain the voltage constant, what will happen? The load will continue to be fed. But if I don't maintain the voltage a constant, then I can have a relay which will trip on either over voltage or under voltage and do an anti-islanding to the DG. So for these reasons, synchronous machines, when interfaced to the grid, are operated either in constant power or constant var mode. Now, supposing I have a PCC. PCC is where you're going to interface the DG, synchronous machine, to the utility. So it might be a small substation, and I might have a large machine, right? If the synchronous machine is large compared to the utility at the point of PCC, then possibly you can use the synchronous machine also for voltage control. Okay, so this will likely take over voltage regulation, and the generation will likely take over voltage regulation. That means it may regulate it more, and it may disturb the already planned strategy for voltage regulation on the utility side. So your voltage regulators may go into undesirable tap positions, extreme tap positions, which is not very desirable, right? Or on the other hand, or this is one possibility from the DG to the utility. On the other hand, utility side faults may drive the excitation of the DG into extreme limits. I explained to you what this means. If there's a deep voltage sag, the exciter will hit the maximum limit. If there is a swell, it may hit the minimum limit. And so this can drive the regulators to undesirable set points. And remember, once the fault or anything is cleared, you have to recover from it and come back to the steady point, and that may not be possible. So that's why this explanation is to tell you why it is not very good to operate the DGs where interfaced with the synchronous machine in the voltage regulator mode. So the best thing is you have a direct transfer trip between the utility breaker and the generation interconnection breaker. Another reason why this voltage regulation coming from the synchronous machine is not good is the reactances of the synchronous machines. Normally, synchronous machines have a subtransient reactance of around 15%, okay, and a transient reactance of around 25%, and a steady state reactance of around 100%. Whereas the transformers, so the utility will be connected at the interface through a transformer, so that impedance is around 5 to 6 percent. Right. So you are using, so it is low impedance. Low impedance means voltage regulation is good. Large impedance means voltage regulation will be poor because there will be a huge drop across the impedance itself. So to transfer the voltage regulation control from the utility to the synchronous machine will not be possible because of this large difference in the impedances. So to make a long story short, operate the synchronous machines only in constant reactive power or constant power factor mode rather than in the voltage regulation mode whenever we use. So what are the consequences of this? The harmonic voltage distortion may increase to intolerable levels if your generator is trying to supply adjustable speed drive loads. This is when you try to operate it in a constant voltage mode, okay, because of its large impedances. And you may not have enough of, because it is high, you know. See, I would have set a overcurrent relay thinking the transformer impedance is 5 to 6%. Whereas for a machine, it is around 25%. So the fault current will be lesser with this high impedance. So the fault current may not be sufficient to trip the breaker. Okay, it may not be sufficient to trip the breaker or blow off the fuses. So the fault will persist because of the high impedance of the synchronous machine, high impedance of the synchronous machine. And a voltage sag experienced when elevator motors are being started will, you know, your lamps may go off. Okay. So these are some of the problems and issues you have with synchronous machines. So the generators, the alternators must be sized considerably larger than the load which you want to supply for reliability, for better reliability. Now there is one more problem with alternators. Because of, though I think you all remember from your machines how the three-phase voltage is produced in an alternator. So this voltage will have a third harmonic component, right? Now you can ask me, even on the utility side, all the generators I use are alternators, even they will have third harmonic components. But what happens, remember, these third harmonic components are zero sequence components. Clear? So on the utility side, I can have the delta winding in the transformer. And you know, in delta, the delta blocks zero sequence components. And therefore, these third harmonic currents will not be reflected in the line. Okay. So this problem is resolved on the utility side because of the delta winding of the transformer. But on the DG side, when I am going to use the synchronous machine as it is and interconnect it to the interface, there is no delta winding. And therefore, these high third harmonic currents will flow in the generator and they can also flow into the system. One way of reducing this is in the design of the alternator, where we use a two-third winding, pitch winding. So two-third is a pitch factor, and this will minimize the third harmonic component. Otherwise, we have to pay some special attention because third harmonic is zero sequence. And you all know that zero sequence currents flow through the neutral. So you must design the neutral reactor properly. Okay, so this is another problem you may encounter with synchronous machines. Clear? So to summarize, synchronous machines are quite popularly used. Alternators are quite popularly used, especially with small diesel generators, reciprocating engines, and combustion engines, as prime was. And it is best not to operate them in voltage regulation mode. Instead, we can operate them in constant power factor mode. The second type of machine used is the asynchronous machine or the induction machine. So that is an induction generator. An induction generator is actually same as an induction motor. And the motor is driven faster than the synchronous speed. The motor is driven faster than the synchronous speed. The only problem here is that I have to provide excitation. So I think you remember from your induction machine theory, right? You have a no load current which composes of the magnetizing component and the working component. So that magnetizing component is required. That is the excitation component. That is required. Okay, so I need another source to provide this. Normally, this is done by using capacitors. So the capacitors are used, and these capacitors will be excited from the grid itself. These capacitors will be excited from the grid itself to supply the necessary magnetizing component to the induction machine. Okay. So you can add this, and additionally you can also add some the capacitors to improve the power factor. The only issue with this is that this may give you some other resonant frequencies which may coincide with some harmonic frequencies and cause heavy currents to flow through the capacitors. Here islanding can easily be prevented, because if I draw the reactive power from the grid, when the grid is blocked, obviously this reactive power also is blocked and the machine does not generate. So induction machines are very popularly used with wind turbines. And another issue with the induction generator is what is called as a self-excitation. So what can happen is when suddenly it is disconnected, isolated on a capacitor bank. So the capacitor bank has some charge, right? It is charged. So the induction generator can continue to charge for some time. But then the capacitor, as it generates, the capacitor voltage will drop. So the induction generator, the generated voltage also will drop. So this is an unregulated voltage and can easily be detected. Right? And so you can actually use it for anti-islanding strategy. Detection of this voltage deviation can be used to trigger an isolation of the DG, which is interfaced using an induction generator. But this can sometime result in a condition called as ferroresonant, which occurs in transformers or reactors, which can cause damaging voltages. And you have all studied in machines, the induction generator, when there is unbalance, there's a very complex dynamics and a lot of transients are involved. So as a thumb rule, we should see that the induction machine voltage remains greater than 60%, then it will continue feeding the fault. So this voltage level is also sufficient to maintain the excitation levels for the machine. Okay. Now today we have, in the recent past, a newer technology which is called as the doubly fed induction generators. Okay, so these are all some very interesting technologies. Now, the third way a DG can be interfaced to the utility is through the use of power converters, right? So all the DG technologies, they generate either DC or non-power frequency AC. So even wind will not, because the speed, wind speed, turbine speed changes, right? If you want to generate the voltage at a fixed frequency of say 50 hertz or 60 hertz, you must have a gear arrangement. And this gear ratio has to keep changing because on the input side, the speed varies. It's a very complex mechanical design. Instead, if I do away with the gear, then what happens? I get a variable frequency. So I need a power electronic converter to convert this variable frequency to fixed frequency. Okay. And or if I use solar, so solar gives me variable DC. I will use a chopper DC to DC converter and convert it to a fixed DC. And I need an inverter to convert it to AC and interface. So this power converter interfaces are very, very popular. So today we use, earlier thyristors were used, today thyristors are no longer used. We use IGBTs or even MOSFETs for designing the inverters. So these also have a lot of harmonic issues. So a simple square wave inverter has a lot of very high harmonic content. And today we have almost over 300, 400 configurations and control schemes for the inverters to produce a sinusoidal voltage using PWM techniques. So there is lot of work done in PWM techniques and also in the design of the converter per se. You have matrix converters, resonant converters, zero switching converters, zigzag converters, and so on. So these all, experiment with the converter topology. And then you have sinusoidal pulse width modulation, then space vector modulation, and then selective harmonic elimination modulation, 120 degree, and so on. So many different types of PWM techniques. So using a combination of converter topology and PWM technique, we can get a nearly good sinusoidal voltage by using power converters. So this is how the system interface looks with a power converter. So I have a DC, okay, typically consider this to be a solar. The DC is obtained from a solar. Then I have an inverter. Then we have filters, LC filters to remove and reduce the harmonics. And then it is interfaced to the grid, right? And I sense the voltage and current and use that to generate my switching for the inverter switches. So the switching now is very high. So even if we can go up to 20 kilohertz to create a near sinusoidal voltage. And the filter can remove all these high frequency components. But sometimes resonance can create a problem. Generally, with a good design, the lowest order harmonic is generally the fifth order harmonic, can be kept within 3%. And we have fantastic inverter configurations with a combination of PWM techniques that can maintain a total harmonic distortion level to less than 5%. Okay. And when we interface it, these inverters always try to generate currents which is in phase with the voltage. Right. If you have a standalone capability, then it could be different. Then the current will follow the load. If you have a UPF load, the current will be UPF. If you have a lagging load, the current will be a lagging power factor. But once we interface, then it will always try to generate current in UPF. Then there is no inertia here. There are no moving parts. There's no kinetic energy in the inverter, right? So you can quickly switch it on and off. All that you have to do is you have to block the signals for switching the thyristors or IGBTs or MOSFETs, whatever you're using, which can be done instantaneously almost. So the changes take place in excuse me, milliseconds. Whereas rotating machines like synchronous machines and induction machines, they have a huge inertia and you cannot suddenly stop or start them because of the inertia. So they take several cycles to respond. Clear? Next, the maximum current which the inverter can feed a fault is limited by the capacity of the IGBTs. This is normally around 2 per unit. Whereas with rotating machines, they can feed fault currents of up to 5 to 6 per unit. Okay. So once the current reaches these values, the inverter will, trip. It can be, you can have a predetermined time and remove the inverter from service. So this is good. But then if there are some relays which operate after a delay, then this may not be very good for the protection. So in this session, we saw the three main methods of interface, that is the synchronous machines, the induction machines, and the power converters. And we also saw some of the problems which these may create. Thank you.